ഡോക്ടർ നാരായണൻ പ്രസിഡന്റ് ഓഫ് ഐ എ പി കേരള, ഡോക്ടർ ബാല സെക്രട്ടറി, ഡോക്ടർ അനന്തകേശവൻ നാഷണൽ വൈസ് പ്രസിഡന്റ്, ഡോക്ടർ രമേഷ് കുമാർ സെക്രട്ടറി ഹോണററി സെക്രട്ടറി ജനറൽ 2018-19, റെസ്പെക്ടഡ് ടീച്ചേഴ്സ്, കൊളീഗ്സ് ആൻഡ് ടുഡേ ഇസ് ദി 9th സെഷൻ ഓഫ് ബിയോണ്ട് ഹൊറൈസൺ മീറ്റ് ദി ഡോയൻ സീരീസ് ആൻഡ് ടുഡേ സ്പീക്കർ ഈസ് Dr. Jayashri Muralidharan, Professor of Pediatrics, PGI, Chandigarh, and Madam is in charge of critical care as well as the pediatric emergency unit, a well-known figure in the arena of pediatric critical care and emergency care. And on behalf of IAP Calicut, as well as on behalf of IAP Kerala, a warm welcome to you, Madam. To this Zoom meeting. Jayashri Madam. Then this session is chaired by Dr. Ajit Kumar VT. He is the head of the Department of Pediatrics, Government Medical College, Kozhikode. Warm welcome to you, Dr. Ajit. And I also welcome all the senior faculty members, all my respected teachers, colleagues, and friends to this Zoom meeting. And I request our state president Dr. Narayanan for the president. Just two words, Dr. Narayanan. Okay. He already conveyed me that to save the time, he's conveyed all the blessing to this Zoom meeting. And I invite Dr. Anandakeshwar is not there, I think. Nihas, whether the Anandakeshwin is present?
No, sir. No, don't.
So I invite Dr. Ramesh, who is the convener of this scientific committee. Anandakeshwin, and yeah. for National Vice President's remarks.
Good evening. Respected Chairperson Dr. Ashraf, Dr. Nihas, my dear friend Ramesh, other senior faculty members, Dr. Ajit Kumar, and one face I am seeing every day is Dr. Shashiran sir. Namma palaya Shashiran sir ella divasam kaanunnathil valareyadhigam sandosham undu. And anyway, one thing I want to congratulate IEP Kozhikode, because many speakers we heard previously. Many topics also we heard, but I don't know. I not heard about the madam, Jayashri madam much. So I would like to congratulate IAP Kozhikode for selecting wonderful speakers from all over India. And also now this is a season of fluid. Mr. Day before yesterday we had ORS fluid. Yesterday now we got breastfeeding fluid, natural fluid of this one. Now you got IV fluid also. So I think. It is a very important topic to discuss, because this time Kuhas, the first paper, first question was body fluid composition and diabetes insipidus, cerebral salt wasting, and it was first paper, first question was this one. I think the topic is very relevant.
Nihas, am I audible, Nihas?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, some technical audible. Problem with Anandakeshwan. So I now invite Dr. Ramesh, who is the chief coordinator of this scientific committee of this event, for opening remarks. Over to you, Dr. Ramesh.
Thanks, Dr. Ashraf. Respected Chairperson, Dr. Ashraf, Secretary of Kozhikode Branch, Dr. Nihas, our chief guest of the day, Dr. Anandakeshwan, our Vice President, Salson, State President, Dr. Narayan, Secretary, Dr. Bala, our seniors here, Chairperson of the day, Dr. Ajit, HOD Pediatrics, my scientific convener, Dr. Vijay Kumar, and seniors, Dr. Shashi Saran, sir, as well as Srinivasan, sir, and I can see a good number who have logged in from outside Kerala. I had a lot of queries in the evening also. Send the link. and even Dr. Kunji Musa from Bahrain. So, so many people have logged in today. This is, we have got a great the senior academician with us to deliver an exciting session. And even when I messaged ma'am also, she said I would make it quite exciting. I was quite sure. And Dr. Jayasri, as such, she has one single message speaks for her credibility in the sense she is the second most influential researcher in the field of pediatric critical care. And she has got such a lot of adoring her disciples or students across the country. I mean, a lot of them have already logged in quite early itself to listen to ma'am. And in despite, one thing I must say, despite all her academic laurels and professional credentials, she is one person who always remained grounded. And that speaks so much about Sujayasri, ma'am. Ma'am, we are all fortunate to have you here with us for this great academic session. And I mean, the Doyle's series will be really blessed with her presence in the one of these sessions. So we are quite privileged to have you here, and best wishes to IAP Kerala and IAP Kozhikode for continuing with the Doyle series, and let us have a great academic learning experience here today. And welcome all my dear friends who are logged in today. Thank you so much, Jaya IAP.
Thank you, Dr. Ramesh. Now we are straight away going to the scientific session. Today's topic is fluid therapy in critically ill children. In the beginning, as Dr. Srinivasan sir rightly pointed out, there are a lot of things to relearn and delearn, especially in the area of emergency care and intensive care and in fluid therapy. And today's speaker is Dr. Jayasri Muralidharan. I invite Dr. Ajit Kumar to chair the session.
Thank you, Dr. Ashraf. Dear teachers, national leaders of IAP, state leaders of IAP, and dear friends and colleagues. It's an honor to be chairing this session. A speaker who is, as Ramesh sir has said, a second most influential researcher in pediatric critical care. And she heads the emergency and critical care unit of in PGI Chandigarh. And not only that, she has been the one of the main leading figure in implementing the IAP BLS and having our own strategy. And a lot of things can be said about her. The most important thing I would say, as Dr. Ramesh has said, a person so humble despite her lofty credentials. And going to the topic, we all know that the lot of changes have occurred in the field of fluids during the past few years. Previously, we used to have this isolate P, which now for the many years we are not using it. And isolate P was our maintenance fluid for such a long time, and which has changed over time. And we know that there are a lot of sick children who needs a real guiding on fluid therapy, especially those with pneumonia, severe pneumonias, ARDS, and those with heart diseases who are critically ill, so that we have to use maintenance fluids very judiciously, so that they don't become because iatrogenically sick because of over fluid therapies. And so fluid therapy has become very important in the management of critical ill children, especially many things like ultrasound, looking at the inferior vena cava, looking at the cardiac an echocardiogram, and everything has revolutionized the management of fluid therapy in critically ill children. I'm really hoping that all of you will change the practice after this. It should be a real path-breaking talk, and also a attitude change talk after hearing Madam's lecture. Over to Madam for this talk on maintenance fluid therapy in critically ill children.
A very good evening to all of you. Is everybody able to see the screen, and am I audible clearly?
Yes, ma'am.
Madam, yeah. Okay, you are audible, madam.
Yeah. Good evening to all. My dear teachers, national leaders, senior pediatricians, colleagues, friends, students, the list is endless. I thank IAP Calicut IIP Kerala for having started this series. I think it's one of the best things that has happened with this COVID pandemic and taking knowledge to the doorstep of everyone. And I really feel very fortunate to have been selected as one of the speakers for this series. As the chairperson rightly said, that the evidence is so much progressing every day and evolving daily that we have to unlearn many things, many concepts that we possibly learned during our undergraduate and our postgraduate days. So that's precisely what I'm going to touch upon in my talk, Fluids in Critically Ill Children. And I thank the organizers because this is something which is very close to my heart. So if I have to put in a nutshell what is going to be the objectives and what do you expect out of this next 30 minutes, is I'm going to touch upon when, what, and how we do fluids in critically ill children. So this is basically what I'm going to do in the light of the current evidence. As we all know, this is the commonest medical intervention that we all practice. In fact, one nephrologist who is a pioneer in hyponatremia isotonic fluids, he has named this beautifully as reverse nephrology. He goes on to describe in one of his commentaries that how nephrologists are always eager to remove fluids, but he always talks about fluid therapy, how to give fluids, and therefore he calls this as a reverse nephrology. I think this is a very beautiful term that he has used for the IV fluid medication that we do in critically ill patients. Traditionally, fluids were designed to provide free water and electrolytes in a child who is fasting, and it's essential supportive care in a variety of diseases. But what one must understand is that IV fluid therapy has become very complex over the years with increasing advances. And more importantly, it's not as innocuous as once it was thought to be. So let us look at the timeline of our understanding and how in different periods the understanding has changed because so much of evidence has come in. So let us start from the time when Rivers et al. Published their first study on the early goal-directed therapy, which was in the year 2001 in the New England Journal of Medicine. The emphasis in that particular study was how to give fluids to achieve certain set goals or targets, what was called as a therapeutic endpoints, and goal-directed giving fluids, vasoactives, or whatever it may be. So the practice leaned towards giving more fluid boluses to achieve the correct numbers. This is what the Rivers et al. Study on early goal-directed therapy taught us in the early 2000s. So the focus of the Rivers study was more on the resuscitative fluids and getting the circulation going and getting the therapeutic endpoints in place. While there was emphasis on this, at the same time between 2003 to 2009, we saw a lot of papers coming up specifically related to maintenance fluid therapy, where people started questioning the role of isolite P, which I haven't used any other fluid in my residency other than isolite P, and even in my early days of senior residency. So there were a lot of concerns, a lot of papers which raised concerns about hospital-acquired hyponatremia and a whole lot of evidence which started coming out first in the perioperative period, and then it started coming out in the critically ill patients, both adults as well as children, that how hypotonic fluids are not good because they increase the incidence of hyponatremia and thereby the complications which are related to hyponatremia. And in the current decade, what we are now seeing is the third phase of the fluid therapy, which is where we have resuscitated, we have used maintenance, but now the concerns are all about the fluid which has gone in, is sitting in the different tissues of the organs and is causing problems of fluid overload, organ dysfunction, and the kind or type of fluids that what was sacrosanct about normal saline as the crystalloid of choice, being the cheapest, you push normal saline, that's what is recommended. Slowly this notion is being debated, and there are evidence against these unbalanced crystalloids, I would be touching upon it later, of how it is causing several problems like acute kidney injury, hyperchloremia. So this decade is talking more about fluid overload, organ dysfunction, how we need to remove and what kind of fluid we need to use in patients who are critically ill. So we can see that there are so many things that we need to unlearn, as we look at the timeline of the understanding of the concepts of fluid. We all know the indications of fluids because we are using it day in and day out. Whatever may be the reason that we give fluids, the indications are primarily three. We give fluids for resuscitation, which is basically the objective is to normalize hemodynamics, to get the organ function going. And replacement indication is when we want to restart or bring the intracellular fluid volume to normal, replace the ongoing gut or renal losses. And the maintenance fluid indication is mainly to provide glucose to the brain and to match the insensible losses, which may be occurring in a child who is not able to take orally. So whatever may be the reason that we start fluids, it has to fall under one of these indications: resuscitation, replacement, or maintenance. What is important for all of us to remember, whatever may be the indication that we start fluids for, it's the needs are dynamic. They keep changing. They keep changing in the same patient as the disease evolves or during the course of the hospital stay. And this is where the concept, what is called as the ROS, which stands for resuscitation, optimization, stabilization, and evacuation. This is important. And in the next, the later part of my presentation, I would be concentrating on this with the relevant literature, which has changed the way we look at this concept of resuscitation, optimization, stabilization, and evacuation. So coming first to the first indication, which is resuscitation, this is a first hit. For example, a septic shock, a child developed shock, which may be secondary to sepsis. The phase here is that there is hypoperfusion, so what we call as the ebb phase. The question that a clinician asks are two: when to start fluids, and what is going to be the benefit of the fluids. These are the two questions that we need to ask ourselves when we say, for example, see a patient with septic shock. Fluid, giving fluids in this particular phase is mandatory. The child is not going to be able to do well if we don't give fluids in this particular phase. This is what we need to understand. The type of fluids is always a crystalloid. We can debate between whether it is an unbalanced crystalloid that we need to use or a balanced crystalloid, which I would be touching upon later. Since we are trying to resuscitate the circulatory volume, the rate of the fluid administration has to be fast. So that is where we say is a bolus administration. And our target is to optimize both the macro, that is all the vital parameters, at the same time the microcirculation. So once our numbers become normal, those numbers need to translate into a good organ perfusion and tissue perfusion, what we call as a microcirculation. And the time frame, since it's something that we have to do rapidly, this has to be within minutes. The aim in this particular phase is to correct shock with achievement of adequate perfusion pressure. Now let us see the triggers for the fluid bolus. Now I would divide this, the concept, into two basic phases: the pre-feast trial phase and the post-feast trial phase. So the feast trial got published in 2011, and I'm sure all of you are very well aware that it kind of challenged our concept and our understanding that fluids are the panacea as soon as a critically ill patient comes. So there was a survey which was conducted in 391 ICU in the year 2007. And the interesting part of this survey was 44% of fluid resuscitation episodes, the trigger was an impaired tissue perfusion or a low measured cardiac output. However, the point to be noted, nearly one third of the fluid resuscitation episodes were based on simply abnormal vital signs, abnormal BP, abnormal heart rate, maybe a low urine output, or maybe a low CVP, without evidence for impaired tissue perfusion, like maybe say a lactate. When the same survey was repeated in the same ICUs in 2014, which is now a post-feast trial era, the things changed. The triggers became more conservative. So what did they find? They found now 61% of fluid resuscitation episodes were based on the trigger, which said that there was an impaired tissue perfusion or a low measured cardiac output. So there was an increase from 44 to 61. And there was a decrease in the trigger, which was based simply on abnormal vital signs, which is basically what we call as a macrocirculatory parameters. So this clearly shows that after the FEAST trial, people have become more conservative. And we all know that the FEAST trial clearly showed that administration of fluid bolus, either saline or 5% albumin, increased the 48 hours mortality when compared with patients who did not receive any bolus at all. They said that fluid bolus, the children who, this study was conducted in the sub-African children, where there were a lot of comorbidities, malnutrition, malaria was a common infection, there was a lot of anemia. So for some reason, because of these existing comorbidities, these children could not handle the fluid bolus that was given, and that resulted in mortality. So clearly the triggers have become more conservative. I know from our personal experience in PGI that we don't keep pushing fluid bolus at the drop of our hat just because there is a tachycardia. So we have become now more conservative, and clinical practice has now moved away from simply chasing numbers or vital signs without looking at any impaired tissue perfusion markers. There was a publication recently in the Lancet Respiratory Medicine 2019, where they reanalyzed the FEAST data. And what did they find? Because the FEAST trial actually threw up a lot of debate. There was a set of people who were refusing to believe that fluid bolus could have caused mortality. So this FEAST trial data probably is one thing which has been under a lot of scrutiny, analysis and reanalysis, and several publications have come out of it. The latest publication in the Lancet Respiratory Medicine 2019 clearly states that in resuscitation of febrile children, albumin and saline boluses cause respiratory and neurological dysfunction, hyperchloremic acidosis, and reduction in hemoglobin concentration, probably because of a dilution effect. So fluid resuscitation with unbuffered electrolyte solutions like normal saline, because they don't contain the buffer, may cause harm and their use should be cautioned. However, whether a buffered solution in lower volume is actually going to be useful in these subset of patients because of the coexisting morbidities, that needs to be evaluated further. So the point that they drive home is that the fluid bolus resuscitation may have a short-term benefit, but long-term harm. And it is very important that whenever we decide to give a fluid bolus, there has to be a provision for a good respiratory support, if possible. The second point of contention, apart from the volume, the rapidity, and the bolus, is whether we need to give balanced or unbalanced crystalloids as a resuscitation fluid. The word balance relates to two things: minimal effect on the acid-base balance and a low chloride content. So very often we relate balanced fluids to simply the chloride content. It is not true. There are two things which should be there to call a particular fluid as a balanced crystalloid or a buffered solution. One, it has to have minimal effect on the acid-base balance, what we call as the strong ion difference. And second, it has to have a lower chloride content. So why there is so much of body of evidence that is coming in favor of balanced fluids? So what people have found is that the chloride content in normal saline is basically a chloride-rich crystalloid. The chloride first causes a hyperchloremic non-normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. This may not be so troublesome, but what is troublesome is that it causes an afferent arteriolar constriction, reduces the renal perfusion, and increases the chances of acute kidney injury. So the second one, the acute kidney injury, is the one which is now causing people to compare normal saline with balanced crystalloids, and there have been several studies on this. So what is the evidence right now that we have to summarize? A large prospective open label pilot study compared a chloride liberal fluid like normal saline to a chloride restrictive regimen like plasmalite or a chloride poor albumin. And what did they find? The chloride restrictive group nearly had half the risk of AKI and need for a renal replacement therapy. So they concluded that chloride liberal fluid is associated with more risk for acute kidney injury and higher need for renal replacement therapy. Then came a large multi-center double-blind RCT, which was called the SPLIT trial, which included almost 2,000 critically ill adults. However, they did not find any difference in the incidence of AKI. Another big trial, I'm only putting the big trials here, which was a single center but conducted in 5 ICUs, had about 15,000 patients, was called the SMART trial. AKI was again seen less in the balanced arm. However, there was no difference in mortality, need for renal replacement, or proportion of patients who are left with persistent AKI. So what we have evidence, current evidence, especially in patients with septic shock, adults, we don't have so much forthcoming evidence in children, is that yes, balanced fluid theoretically, physiologically are much better as compared to normal saline for the reasons that, that I have already enumerated. However, when we look at evidence, we still are equipoised. That means there is nothing as such which says that, okay, now replace all normal saline with balanced crystalloids. We are not at that stage as of now. So we still continue to use normal saline, and cost probably is a major factor for us who work in resource limited settings. So when we look at the first phase and how we have evolved as far as the evidence is concerned, we have to be very careful when to give fluids. That is, we have our triggers have to be specific. Tissue hypoperfusion is key. So if we can monitor lactates, we must do it. After, especially after the first bolus, maybe then we should start looking at lactates. I wouldn't say that do lactates as soon as the patient comes to an emergency kind of a setting. But if there is a need for repeated fluid bolus, then it is very important for us to look at organ perfusion parameters. This is important because we all know that what we see and measure as a macrocirculatory parameters may not actually translate into a good microcirculatory parameter. We all know in septic shock, there is what is called as a microcirculation, macrocirculation discordance. So even if we keep pushing fluids because our numbers, hemodynamic parameters are not okay, it is not going to go and translate it into good organ perfusion, and it may actually cause more harm. When we are talking of resuscitation phase, the fluid type has always to be isotonic. The rate of administration depends on the clinical parameters and the coexisting comorbidities like anemia and malnutrition. Respiratory worsening should be anticipated in children with comorbidities and probably mitigated by prompt respiratory support if available. Balanced fluids are coming up in a big way. Final word is awaited, and cost, of course, is of major concern. With this, once we have resuscitated, we move on to the optimization phase. The aim in the optimization phase here is that we administer fluids. The patient may still continue to require fluids. For example, a septic shock. Intermittently, there will be fluid requirement. The fluids are administered according to individual needs and reassessed on a regular basis. Now, this is very, very important at this particular stage. We can't just blindly keep pushing fluids based on certain parameters. Now, what happens in this particular phase? The flow is established because you have resuscitated the patient. So now the injury is a second hit to the tissues. And this hit, the cause is an ischemia first, followed by reperfusion. This is the organs, all organs suffer because of initial ischemia followed by a rapid reperfusion. So the question here the clinician has to ask, when do I stop fluids? What is the risk if I keep pushing more fluids to the patient? This is exactly opposite of the questions that we asked during the resuscitation phase. And fluids in this phase are titrated and given based on the fluid responsiveness, which I would be talking in the later slides. And it should be based on individual needs. And our target here is not macrocirculation. We are basically concerned about the organ perfusion. And the time frame of this particular phase can go on to hours. Now, what happens to the fluid that we give? This is important for us to understand the optimization phase. It has been shown in studies that whatever fluid we push, less than 5% of the crystalloid remains in the intravascular compartment at the end of 1 hour. And this is exactly what this particular slide shows. On the x-axis is the time from the fluid bolus administration in minutes. And on the y-axis is the cardiac index. So you can see that at 60 minutes, again, there is a fall in the hemodynamic parameters, suggesting that whatever fluid we give, it brings about the response in the initial 5 minutes. And subsequently, at 60 minutes, you're back to square one. So why? What happens? The fluid that we have given basically seeps into the interstitial compartment and results in tissue edema. So at one end of the spectrum, you had hypovolemia, which was the resuscitation phase. And at the later part, which is the evacuation phase, you're having hypervolemia. So your volume status, what patient desires, is a truth which lies somewhere in the middle, probably at this particular aspect. So therefore, it is very important for us to determine, because if you push more, the patient is going to become hypervolemic. If you don't push, the patient will go into hypovolemia. So you keep swinging between the two extremes, and you want your patient to remain in this optimal phase. And therefore, at this point, you have to have certain objective parameters by which you decide whether the patient is going to respond to more fluids or not. And actually, it has been seen that only half of the patients are fluid responsive. And this is where a little bit of physiology is very helpful for us, that we have to realize when we look at this graph that at the lower part of the curve, when it is peaking, there a small increase in filling pressures of the ventricle will produce a good stroke volume. That means at this particular stage, the patient is fluid responsive. As soon as the patient goes to this particular phase where the curve is flattening here, this is the point where B, there, even if you give fluids, there is going to be a very small increase in the cardiac output. And if you continue to give fluids, then all this is going to become extravascular lung water. So basically what we are doing by assessing fluid responsiveness is we are trying to gauge that at what point our patient is. Is our patient at A, so the patient is going to respond to fluids, or the patient has already gone to B, and whatever fluids you are going to give is not going to make much difference to the cardiac output. And in fact, it is only going to cause more harm. Also, there was an interesting study in which they found where they saw the fluid responsiveness in percentage over 424 patients with sepsis. And what they found is probably something very important for all of us because it has great clinical implications. At 0 hours, nearly 60%, more than half of the patients were fluid responsive, the dark blue bar. And as the time evolved, 2 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours, and 8 hours, the proportion of patients who were fluid responsive was decreasing. And at 8 hours, only 3% were fluid responsive. So what we need to understand is at the time the patient comes in the resuscitation phase, the child will be fluid responsive. By the time the child slips into the optimization and stabilization phase, which is hours from this point, the fluid responsiveness is going to decrease. And if we keep on pushing blindly, we are only going to cause more problems. Therefore, it is important that we have certain parameters by which we assess the fluid needs in sick children. Clinical parameters is something that we can't base our judgment, because we know that in critically ill patients, the clinical parameters are modified by several other things. We all know that the fluid responsive yardsticks are static as well as dynamic. I'm not going into too much details, but we don't depend too much on static parameters because they do not reflect the status on the Frank-Starling's curve, which I showed, and they are affected by a host of other factors and they have poor predictive utility. So basically, intensive care now depends more on the dynamic parameters. There are multiple of them. And as you see, there are like pulse pressure variations where we see the pulse contour analysis and see the difference between the maximum and the minimum, the maximum and the minimum. And anything which is more than 12% increase is taken as a cutoff. And we say that, okay, the child will be fluid responsive. But there are certain prerequisites. You need an arterial line, the patient needs to be well sedated, and there will be several confounders which will be there in a patient who's in ICU, as a result of which you may not be able to interpret these parameters well. I think in those who do intensive care these days are in fact more comfortable with the echo probe than the stethoscope. And therefore, I know that all of you are very good and you immediately pick up your echo and ultrasound probe and do the IVC diameter variation. All you need to remember for the pediatricians who have joined, that when the child is spontaneously breathing, we call it as a collapsibility index. And when the patient is on mechanical ventilation, we call the IVC diameter as a distensibility index. And we take more than 50% collapse with each breath. If it is there, then child is likely to be responsive. or a distensibility index of more than 18%, then you give fluids and possibly the child is going to respond. And a simple bedside test, what is called as an autofluid bolus, you just do a passive leg raising test, wait for 30 to 60 seconds. So this is nothing but as if you have given a fluid bolus, whatever fluid is there in the venous circulation gets pushed towards the heart. You check the stroke volume variation, and more than 12%, it indicates that if you give fluid, the patient is going to respond. So these are some of the methods. These are the thresholds. These are the area under the curve. And these are the pediatric area under the curve given, the ROCs, the sense, the predictive index. And out of these, variation in aortic blood flow velocity has been found to be the most predictive, which of course is not something that we can do in every patient. So some of the things that we use clinically is of course the fluid challenge, the passive leg raising test, the pulse pressure variation. And I feel that most of the young intensivists, they go more by the IVC diameter, collapsibility or the distensibility. So in the optimization phase, what do we have? We basically need to restrict our fluid administration and not be like what we did in our resuscitative phase. And here it is important for us to use predictors of fluid responsiveness, but remember the caveat, how to measure whether the responsive fluid, what you gave, is success or failure, because finally you have to rely on global parameters. And if there is a dichotomy between the macro and the micro circulation, still it is not going to give you the answer. However, this is the best that you can do at this particular stage. And second thing, which again, we need to unlearn, is an early use of vasopressors. Like when I was a resident, senior resident, and early faculty, always we were taught that before filling the tank, please don't use vasopressors, because you're going to cause organ ischemia, organ hypoperfusion, and going to worsen the problems. But now what evidence says and how it has evolved is that by using early pressors, you're actually recruiting blood from the venous compartment. You're actually pushing more blood from the venous compartment, and waiting to start vasopressors till the fluid resuscitation is complete, you may actually miss the window where the patient is going to do well and going to respond. Then we go to the stabilization phase. So once we have resuscitated, we have optimized the fluid with the help of fluid responsiveness predictors. Then we go to the stabilization phase. Now stabilization phase is again a second hit. The flow may be there or may not be there. Again, there is some bit of ischemia reperfusion which is going on. And the clinician has to ask two questions, same questions. When do I stop the fluids and what is the risk of fluids? And the objective of this particular phase is basically to provide the water and electrolytes to replace the ongoing losses and whatever is required to provide organ support. Therefore, it will be based purely on the individual needs. There is nothing like one formula that this is what you need to give. The target is the organ function, and our aim has to be to maintain either zero or negative fluid balance. And the time frame will be days. It is not in hours like what we saw in the previous phase. Now we all have grown up using the Holliday-Segar formula. This was the landmark study which was published by Holliday and Segar in pediatrics in 1957. And we all know, and probably we have memorized, because we don't even need to look at the mnemonics or the reckoners. We can just our memory, just chart this for any patient, any child. But there has been a lot of criticism over the years for this Holliday-Segar, which we have grown up with, because the calculations were based on findings of healthy children. And we are extrapolating these calculations to an acutely sick child who has a very different physiology altogether. The estimated energy expenditure based on body weight is again unreliable in a critically ill child. Also, we need to remember that there is an impaired excretion of free water because of a syndrome of inappropriate ADH, and the kidneys are excreting a hypertonic urine. They're retaining electrolyte-free water and they are throwing out electrolytes. So this is what we call as generation of electrolyte-free water by the kidneys. When all this is happening, so the small circle is the SIADH. So there is free water retention. Over and above, a child who is in ICU has less calorie expenditure. So we would end up overestimating the intake if we use the Holliday-Segar formula. The kidneys are causing solute diuresis, excreting less of water. There is an alteration in sodium-potassium pump, intracellular translocation of sodium, which is again going to cause hyponatremia. And over and above this altered physiology, you are giving hypotonic fluids, that is isolate P, according to Holliday-Seger formula. So this is a sure shot recipe. And that is exactly what people shown. These are the multiple studies. I've just put the important ones which changed practice in pediatrics as well as adults. So they said that everything is going to cause hyponatremia. And this is exactly what the table is showing. Most of the studies show that hypotonic fluid, that is the isolate P, increases hyponatremia. And the isotonic fluid, which they suggested, some said not conclusive, but most said that it does not cause any dysnatremia and therefore it is safe to be used in patients as a maintenance fluid. Some more recent evidence has just come. In 2015, Friedman et al. Did an RCT in 110 children comparing isotonic with hypotonic at maintenance rates for 48 hours. They found that the difference in sodium after 48 hours was just minimal. So they were not convinced that the hypotonic fluids actually cause hyponatremia. The two children who developed hyponatremia, however, belonged to the hypotonic group. However, the same year, there was another RCT which was published by McNabb et al. And this RCT is important for two reasons. One, it had a very large sample size of 690 children who required fluids over 6 hours. And second, plasma light was used as the isotonic fluid and not normal saline like what was used in the previous studies. And they found that hyponatremia was significantly less in the isotonic or the plasma light group. In fact, the hypotonic group had more tendency towards seizures. However, the incidence of cerebral edema was similar. There was no risk of hypernatremia or fluid overload in the isotonic group. This is important because most of the naysayers for isotonic fluids as maintenance basically said that if the patient is retaining water, then you restrict water. Why do you want to give more sodium to the patient? It is going to cause hypernatremia and fluid overload. But this particular study in 2015 has refuted that and said that isotonic fluids do not result in any dysnatremia. So where are we in the stabilization phase or the maintenance fluid? The evidence is quite clear, and there is a clear direction in this particular phase that we should not use hypotonic fluids. They significantly increase the risk of acute hyponatremia. Isotonic fluids are physiological, and you don't have to be scared that it is going to increase hypernatremia. The last phase is the evacuation phase. Now here you have given fluids, and this fluid has gone and sat in the different interstitium. So our aim here is to remove the excessive fluid. Either the patient puts spontaneously diuresis, or you induce diuresis, or you go for ultrafiltration or any form of renal replacement therapy. So here what happens is that there is a third hit. So in the first phase, it was the first hit. In these two phases, next it was the second hit. And now we are having a third hit. And in this third hit, what happens is, again, there is an ebb phase. There is no flow. And this phase, as has been described beautifully by certain researchers, is what is called as the global increased permeability syndrome. The fluid seeps, there is a permeability, there is an endothelial dysfunction. And the question that the clinician has to now start asking in this phase is, when to start unloading? When do I remove the fluids, excess fluids for the patient? And what are the benefits of fluid removal? In this particular phase, it is better to give patients oral fluids if possible. Again, tailor it based on the individual needs. Our target is the organ function, and our goal is to maintain a negative fluid balance. We want to keep the patient dry. If you see many intensive care units, they always talk about drying the patient. Either you give diuretics or you restrict the fluids, or maybe you use a renal replacement therapy. And the time frame of this particular phase goes on from days to weeks. So we all know the perils of fluids in critically ill. But these two perils, the fluid overload and worsening organ dysfunction, especially in a patient with sepsis and altered capillary permeability, is very, very crucial for us to remember. Now, this is a Starling principle. It is very different from the Frank Starling principle, which I talked about in the fluid responsive stage. Now, this is one particular figure. The fluid transport across capillary membranes, we need to remember that in a classic Starling model, which is the one which I have highlighted in red, the left side, the fluid leaves the vessel at the arterial end of the capillary bed, primarily because the hydrostatic pressure here exceeds the oncotic pressure. And this fluid re-enters the vessel from the interstitium at the venous end, because the opposite now happens. The hydrostatic pressure is lower than the oncotic pressure. This is the normal fluid transport across capillary membranes in a non-injured endothelium. Once the endothelium is injured, and now everything boils down to endothelium, the glycocalyx, that is the major determinant of this transcapillary fluid shift. And here what happens is that this endothelium becomes leaky. And this leakiness results in the loss of fluid into the interstitium and results in interstitial edema. And the extent of this interstitial edema will vary. It is not that every organ will have the same degree of edema. It will vary between organs. It will vary if there is a localized or a systemic inflammation. So basically what we are saying is that in the phase of evacuation, all the fluid has gone and sat inside. The transcapillary fluid transport is determined by the endothelium, is completely gone for a toss because of the injured endothelium, resulting in interstitial edema, which can be widespread and cause severe organ dysfunction. This is one. And the second concept, which is very interesting, is a concept what we call as a fluid creep. Fluid creep is nothing but defined as a sum of volumes which are used by us to maintain patency of IV line. We may be giving some fluids which is either saline or 5% dextrose. Fluids which are used as vehicle for drugs. There are so many infusions that go on in patients where the fluid is used as a vehicle. Sometimes we give concentrated electrolytes which are added to fluids or given separately. So the sum of all these volumes is basically what we call as a fluid creep. Now, how significant is this fluid creep? Very often when we are working in intensive care, we are always concentrating on the maintenance. We are concentrating on the resuscitation and the boluses that we give. Somewhere we forget about the fluid creep and the amount of fluid that we are giving through all these things. In a retrospective study done from Belgium, almost 10 years, they analyzed about 14,000 patients. And what did they find? That resuscitation fluids only comprise 6.5% of the total mean daily fluid volume, a minuscule portion. Maintenance replacement, which is the blue portion of this circle, with added electrolytes contributed 24.7%. And fluid creep, which is the yellow portion of this wheel, accounted for 32.6, nearly one third of the fluid that we give as is resulting from fluid creep. And another interesting aspect, what happens to the fluid dynamics over time in ICU in the first 5 days? The same study beautifully demonstrated that in the initial phase, that is day one, it is the resuscitation fluids. And as the patient goes to day five, the yellow part of the pie chart increases. So the fluid creep accounted for a quarter of fluids and the main source of the fluid that we push in from day four onwards. So it is not only the glycocalyx and the endothelium and the interstitial edema, but a significant amount of fluid that we give and the fluid creep, which contributes to the fluid overload in the later part of the ICU stay. So what does this fluid do? It finally results in organ dysfunction. And there are several studies in children which have shown either the mortality is increased or there is an acute kidney injury which is increased, but definitely fluid overload is not good. And it is associated with poor outcomes in patient. The only caveat is there is an association between fluid overload and mortality. However, causal relationship has not been conclusively established. And in our own PGI study, which was done in ARDS, we found that as fluid overload increased, the severity of the ARDS increased. Again, by the same mechanism that all this fluid goes and sits in the lung interstitium, increases the lung water, and causes worsening of oxygenation and ARDS. So therefore, at this stage, what we need to do is we need to remove, that is targeted deresuscitation. Probably we need to work as nephrologists here in this particular stage. This can be if the patient spontaneously diuresis, there is nothing like it. That is a normal physiology and that is something that is the best that can happen to the child. However, if not, you start using diuretics or ultrafiltration. Diuretics have an additional role, which is something that is important for all of us to understand. Again, a mechanism which we have to probably relearn, that the microcirculation, when there is interstitial edema, there is a diffusion distance which is increased. The moment you use diuretics, you recruit more microcirculation capillaries by decreasing the diffusion distance and improving the organ perfusion. But remember that de-resuscitation is not simply you just give diuretics and start doing it. It has to be done in steps where you need to have a definite clinical endpoint, set a fluid goal, keep monitoring that fluid goal, set a perfusion and renal safety targets, re-evaluate every 12 or 24 hours to see if the safety limits are reached, and adjust your plan accordingly. So it is very clear that as the child moves through the four phases of fluid therapy, it's a very tightrope walk. When you give inadequate fluids, you basically worsen the tissue hypoperfusion. If you give too much, you're worsening the tissue edema and the organ perfusion. So what do we do? So therefore, we need to follow what is called as a concept of fluid stewardship. Fluid should be approached like antibiotics. You follow the four Ds. It is a drug. You have to have a clear indication and a situation. There has to be a dose and a rate. The duration has to be clearly determined. And you have to de-escalate a graded removal to prevent fluid overload. So is there an ideal fluid which fulfills all the four Ds? No, it cannot be. There is no cookbook formula. One size cannot fit all. You have to have all these important considerations, which I have already discussed. So therefore, there are clear indications for using isotonic fluids in critically ill patients, wherever you need a higher effective osmolality. There you need to use isotonic fluids, for example, shock and resuscitation. Where there is an AVP excess, like hypovolemic states, euvolemic states with AVP excess, like your SIADH, and a post-operative setting. There is no confusion. In these settings, it is always isotonic fluids. Indications for fluid and sodium restriction. There are two or three situations where you would give less fluids as well as restrict the sodium. They are mainly the edematous states like your CCF, nephrosis, oligoaneuric states like your acute kidney injury, where you restrict fluids according to the surface area and your insensible losses. Where do you use hypotonic fluids? Not that they have been thrown away completely. You use them wherever you have clear setting where there is a free water deficit like a hypernatremia. You have a renal concentrating defect like a nephrogenic diabetes insipidus where you need to use hypotonic fluids. Or you have any extra renal free water loss which may happen in burns, premature neonates, fevers, or an infectious diarrhea. There are some disease-specific fluid prescription that as pediatricians, we must always keep in mind. If there is a CNS illness like a meningitis or an encephalitis, we must not restrict fluids to begin with. This is very, very important because we need to maintain a good systemic perfusion to maintain a good cerebral perfusion. So if you start curtailing fluids right from the beginning, you will have problems. Titrate the patient according to the sodium and the input-output chart. If you find that there is a clear evidence of SIADH, then you can restrict the fluids. In all respiratory illness, like your acute bronchiolitis, asthma, pneumonia, if you have to give fluids, it has to be 80% of maintenance. This is because you have to keep in mind the SIADH, which operates in these children. In congestive heart failure, acute myocarditis, you always give restricted fluid because the heart cannot handle. So maybe 50 or maybe 40, it all depends on how your cardiac output and hemodynamic parameters are. Nephrotic syndrome is not a fluid, it's an intravascular fluid depleted state and an interstitial fluid overloaded state. So you have to titrate the fluids based on your serum sodium, your urine output, and your albumin and the oncotic pressure. So therefore, the key messages are, follow the four Ds for fluid therapy, isotonic fluids always for fluid resuscitation. We require more answers on balanced fluids as resuscitative fluids. Hypotonic fluids no longer recommended for maintenance because of high risk of hyponatremia. Post-resuscitation, maintain a conservative fluid strategy to minimize fluid overload and organ dysfunction. Early fluid removal is key to salvage organ systems. Maintaining a fine balance is probably, I think this adage, maintaining a fine balance probably applies to most of the interventions that we do in intensive care, not only fluids. It applies to pressures, it applies to vasoactives, it applies to antibiotics and every intervention that we do in intensive care. We need to maintain a balance and the same applies for the fluids also. And that's a big thank you from the team PICU at PGI Chandigarh. Thank you once again for this opportunity. I would love to take up the questions.
Thank you, madam, for the excellent talk, which was really enlightening. Dr. Ashraf, can you go for the questions?
Yeah, there are many questions in the chat box. I think Dr. Abdul Rauf, I invite Dr. Abdul Rauf to read that questions from the chat box. Rauf? Abdul Rauf, yes, are
sir.
You there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Rauf, if there are more than one device, please switch off the other device.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. You are audible, but some echoing of your sound. Okay, read now.
You better you read that.
Yes. Is it clear now, sir?
Now it is clear. Okay, Rauf.
Yeah. There are five questions. The first question is, what is the ideal fluid for resuscitation in a febrile child?
So basically, in resuscitation, when we use the word resuscitation, I assume that we are talking of hemodynamic compromise. So the fluid would be isotonic, either normal saline or a balanced crystalloid. If the patient has underlying comorbidity, like let's say malnutrition, because that's something we see commonly, or severe anemia, then you need to titrate the rate with the rapidity with which you're going to give these fluids. But when we say resuscitation, then the fluid is isotonic. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, ma'am. The second question, it's from Dr. Nurul Hassan from Bangladesh. He's asking whether is there any precaution if you are which we need to follow if you are using Hartmann's solution in patient with organ dysfunction. He hasn't mentioned which organ dysfunction. Maybe he's mentioned hemodynamic or kidney injury is mentioning.
Basically, Hartmann's solution is a buffered crystalloid. Buffered crystalloids are one which contain lactate, right? So, for example, Ringer's lactate. Your Hartmann solution. So therefore, organ dysfunction, specific organ dysfunction, are you talking of specific organ dysfunction?
He hasn't mentioned it clearly, ma'am.
For example, if like there is a liver dysfunction, I'm just giving an example since you talked about organ dysfunction, and a patient has shock and you need to resuscitate. So normally what happens is that the bicarbonate, it gets converted to lactate when you are otherwise in a liver dysfunction. In a liver dysfunction, this conversion may be problematic. So in such patients, you may use it. It depends on which organ dysfunction. Like in acute kidney injury, maybe you will be very cautious in using Hartmann solution. But buffered crystalloids, balanced crystalloids, they are better when they are organ dysfunctions, because the other one, the unbuffered, like normal saline, you because of the chloride and because of the non-buffered nature, may cause more problems like acute kidney injury.
Okay. Coming to next question, ma'am. In a patient who is having fluid responsiveness, he's asking whether there will be 12% increase in the blood pressure also, like there will be 12% increase in the stroke volume, whether that will be reflected as a 12% change in the stroke blood pressure also is the question.
Basically, we talk about stroke volume variation, 12% increase. There will be some improvement in blood pressure automatically, but I'm not sure whether it is the same 12% that we will talk about. So we are looking basically at the SVV, and this cutoff is given for the stroke volume variation of more than 12%.
Coming to the next question, what is the mechanism of hyponatremia in critically ill children, whether it is related to decreased cortisol or altered thyroid function?
The main mechanism of hyponatremia in critically ill is because of a syndrome of inappropriate ADH, one. And second, it is because of generation of electrolyte-free water by the kidneys. This means that in the presence of ADH, the kidney is not able to excrete the free water. So whatever the kidney excretes is more of electrolytes and less of water. So this is basically what is called as generation of electrolyte free water by the kidneys. And then there may be other things like you give fluids, and thyroid and other things can also be contributing, because these children do have CQ thyroid syndrome, but the major mechanism is the syndrome of inappropriate ADH and the kidney generating the electrolyte free water.
What is the mechanism behind acute kidney injury in hypervolemia? The question is, how does hypervolemia contribute to kidney injury?
So I just showed the diagram in which there is endothelial dysfunction. I showed how interstitial edema occurs, and the way the different organs behave. So when there is fluid overload, the same kind of mechanisms can also occur in the kidneys, and then it can result in fluid overload.
Okay. When to consider colloids for resuscitation?
One of the situation where we in resource limited setting often consider colloids is like, say, a child with nephrotic syndrome comes with septic shock and has a low albumin and a low oncotic pressure. We can consider colloids quite early in resuscitation. And second is in a child with dengue, where the initial response to crystalloid is poor, then we can consider colloids in resuscitation.
What is your opinion about using Ringer lactate as a maintenance fluid?
So basically, we just talked about isotonic fluids have to be used as maintenance fluid. So Ringer lactate is a buffered crystalloid. So it contains low chloride. It contains lactate, which is the buffer. And when we talk of maintenance fluids, like we use normal saline, we can also use Ringer lactate in patients as maintenance fluid. But somehow in our setting, the isotonic fluid that we use for maintenance, we are usually using normal saline, and we reserve Ringer lactate more as a resuscitative fluid, especially in children who are acidotic, because the lactate gets converted into bicarbonate, and therefore the response is much better as compared to simple normal saline. And the concept basically lies in the strong ion difference, which I have not touched upon here. So all these unbuffered crystalloids, basically they cause more acidosis for two reasons. One is they have excess chloride, and second, they cause dilution of the bicarbonate, which is already there in the body. And because of these two factors, they cause problems in the strong ion difference, whereas a buffered crystalloid does not cause this, and therefore it does not cause acidosis. So Ringer lactate probably is, we use more often in diarrheas and situations where we want the acidosis also to get corrected faster. But if you go by the theory of using the isotonic fluids for maintenance, we can use Ringer lactate also. But generally, we prefer to use normal saline.
What is the best diuretic to be used during the de-resuscitation phase, whether it is furosemide or thiazides?
Basically, in critically ill patients, the changes are very dynamic. And therefore, it is important that we have a graded diuresis, which is gentle, and not a brisk diuresis that suddenly there is an excess diuresis and then the patient goes into hypovolemia, or a phase which is beyond the evacuation phase. So therefore, it is probably better if we use diuretics as an infusion. Therefore, furosemide would be a better drug to use.
What is the fluid which we prefer in hyperchloremic acidosis with lactic acidosis?
Fluid we prefer in hyperchloremic.
There is hyperchloremic acidosis.
So basically, it is a situation where we have a mixed acidosis. We have a normal anion gap acidosis as well as a high anion gap acidosis. So the normal anion gap contributed by the hyperchloremia, and the high anion gap contributed by the lactate. So I think Ringer's lactate would be a better fluid to use in this situation, because it has a low chloride and it has a lactate which will take care of the high anion gap metabolic acidosis.
Okay. Another question is whether using isotonic fluids, whether it predisposes for any risk for hypernatremia.
Yeah, I showed you the evidence that initially people thought that if we use too much of normal saline, it is going to probably cause hypernatremia. But we need to understand the kidneys. The more we challenge the kidney with salt, then there is what is called as a secondary desalination. So therefore, this theoretical risk of hypernatremia was somehow not substantiated in majority of the studies. So they have clearly shown that isotonic fluids are not associated with dysnatremia.
Okay. Again, there is a question about do we have enough data to support benefit of balanced fluid in sepsis?
The evidence is evolving. So I have shown you three big studies. The evidence is evolving, and the recent study does show that in sepsis, when you use too much of isotonic fluids, the unbalanced fluids, large volumes. Now, this is the catch. In DK and other situation where you're not using large volume of fluids, there the difference between balanced and unbalanced crystalloids is not coming up. They are equal. In situation like septic shock, where you're using large volume of isotonic crystalloids versus a balanced crystalloid, there the difference is becoming more and more apparent. So there they are finding that balanced crystalloids are better as compared to normal saline or unbalanced crystalloids. And AIIMS has just concluded a multicentric trial where they have compared balanced versus unbalanced crystalloids in children with septic shock. And the data has been analyzed, though it has not been published as yet. We have just analyzed the data. PJ was one of the center. Dr. Juma has done this study. And in that also, we have found that the incidence of acute kidney injury was more in the group which was receiving isotonic saline or unbalanced crystalloids. So I think the evidence is going to evolve in favor of balanced crystalloids very soon, especially in septic shock where large volumes have been used.
Okay. And just one more question, ma'am. In sepsis-induced myocardial dysfunction, when there is a discordance between the macrocirculation and microcirculation, he means the blood pressure is tissue perfusion is maintained, but maybe the BP is on the lower side. How to handle this discordance?
Say that again. Blood pressure is maintained. What did you say?
Blood pressure is on the lower side. Macrocirculation is the parameters are not up to the mark, okay. But microcirculation is preserved. So how to handle this discordance?
Okay. So in a child who has myocardial dysfunction, whether it is sepsis related or related to primary myocardial disease, one important thing that we need to remember is that we should not target BPs which are ideal. A fifth centile BP is something that is quite sufficient because this is an injured myocardium. The higher you target the BP, the myocardium is not going to be able to contract against this afterload. So a BP which is barely like at fifth centile is a BP which is good enough for you. And this like the microcirculation is good, but the macrocirculation is not good. That means that BP probably is adequate for the patient. I would take it as that rather than chasing that BP number.
Yes, ma'am. What is the present status of artificial colloids, ma'am, dextran, Hess and all?
No. I mean, I can't give a final word on that. Like, there's no consensus as such.
Ma'am, just one more query, ma'am. You mentioned about the early initiation of vasopressor. So they're asking how early it should be initiated, whether it should be started in parallel to the first fluid bolus, or how long we should wait for initiation of inotropes.
Yeah. So this is exactly what I was mentioning, that when you look at the sepsis guidelines, septic shock guidelines, previously we used to give the first fluid bolus and then start the vasoactives. Now we start the fluid bolus and we also start the epinephrine. So similarly, we are giving a fluid bolus and then we assess the patient's hemodynamics, macro, maybe the fluid responsiveness and all those parameters in place, echo and everything, and probably start vasopressor early. Early means it is very difficult to pinpoint that this is early. It depends on patient to patient, right? If the patient responds to the first bolus, then probably you may not need to do anything. It's only in those who do not respond to the first bolus when all these questions start coming. So instead of waiting for the three boluses and then labeling fluid refractory or whatever, you probably should start thinking early in terms of vasopressors in such patients.
Okay. there are just one more question, ma'am. In the absence of widespread availability of plasmalite, can we use ringer lactate as a substitute for plasmalite, like ringer lactate as a balanced solution?
Yeah, absolutely. You can use Ringer's lactate as a balanced solution. In fact, probably that is the balanced crystalloid which is cheaply available for us. Plasmalite is, I think it is 10 times more expensive than normal saline.
Yeah.
So in resource limited setting, I wouldn't say that please use plasmalite. That's not right. So therefore, we can go for Ringer lactate, which is a cheap balanced crystalloid that we have.
Okay. I think we have taken most of the questions, ma'am.
Okay, over to you, Ajit, for the
thank you for patient listening to all the questions and answering them for our viewers and it's an evolving phase for our fluid therapies, and maybe after some years we might be having more knowledge on microcirculation, on organ dysfunction, and also about interstitium. And I think interstitium is one thing which is, I think, less investigated, or there is less of research on interstitium fluid and the dynamics of interstitium fluid. I think any other questions to our madam? Thank you, madam, for your patient as well as coming over to Calicut, even though virtually, to enlighten us. And it was a really revealing, and then it was a lot of facts which can be used in our daily practice, especially in intensive care. And I was about the fluid creep. I was really amazed by the fluid creep that you mentioned. And all of us should be aware of the fluid creep, that the amount of fluids that we use while giving drugs and all these things. And it was really enlightening.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed the session. Thanks a lot. And my trip to Calicut has been beautiful and wonderful.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you. Thank you for that excellent deliberation on the fluid balance, how to maintain that delicate balance between the overload or hypovolemia. And a special thanks to that great term, introducing that great term, fluid stewardship. I think all of us should copy that word and paste in our mind while dealing with sick children. The fluid stewardship. Thank you once again, madam, to be with us at this platform. Now I invite our dynamic secretary, Dr. Nihas, for a word of thanks.
Thank you, sir. I like to thank Jayashree madam for taking up our invite and coming to Calicut and deliberating. A nice session for all of us, and making us unlearn many things and learn many things in that 45 minutes talk. Thank you, madam, again for being here and enlightening us. Thank you, Ajit sir, for chairing this session. Sir is always with us for all the activities of IIT Calicut. Along with the department, we are going hand in hand for all the programs. Thank you, Ajit sir, for all the help and this one and sharing this session. I'd like to thank Ramesh sir and Andrikeshan sir for being here on most of the talks of DOINS and giving the opening comments. Thank you, Ramesh sir, and thank you, Andrikeshan sir. All the seniors who joined us today, our president, Narayan sir, Secretary Bala sir, for all the support they are giving on to IEP 44, and all the seniors who joined us today, Ravi sir, you can see Ravi sir, and Shadi sir, all others who joined us, and all my friends, my teachers and colleagues who joined us today, and the team behind this drawing, Ranjit, Vijay Umar sir, Krishna Mohan, Ashraf sir, thank you all for being there, and hopefully one more talk to go in this series which we have planned. And as Ramesh sir was pointing out, possibly we'll be continuing talking. Okay. With a small gap, which is very much needed for all of us. Thank you all for being here, and thank you again. Sir, being here, and good night for the day.
Thank you, Rauf, also.
Meet again. And Rauf is very close to us now. he is always there, and he is the person behind all the activities in the emergency pediatrics nowadays. Thank you, Rav, being there, and all of you for joining us today.
Thank you, madam.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Abdul.